behalf of the ISIS students, it is my pleasure to welcome you all to the 13th Charlemagne Distinguished Lecture. The Charlemagne Distinguished Lecture Series was established in 2010 on the initiative of the ISIS doctoral panel. This lecture series gives us fellows the opportunity to ask scientists who inspired us through their enormous contributions, their achievement, and most importantly, through the enormous impact that they have had on the field of computational engineering science. Through the years, we have had the honor of welcoming, among others, the field medalist Professor Pierre-Louis Lyon, Professor Fred Moller from the MathWorks, and Professor Yann Lecun, the Director of Artificial Intelligence Research at Facebook. Today, I would like to express our cordial welcome to our 13 distinguished lecture series. Here, Professor Marquardt. Before I introduce our distinguished guest speaker, I would like to introduce Professor Malik Baer. Professor Baer is a professor of mechanical engineering at the Pediatrian University and has been the scientific director of ISIS since it was established in 2006. Professor Baer will now say a few words.
Thank you, Rosalia. Every 6 months or so, a steering committee watches in suspense the proposals that the doctoral fellows of ISIS submit for the next Charlemagne speaker. I must say, over a 7-year history, we had some high points and some other points. But I was never as delighted as last winter when the name of Wolfgang Marquardt was proposed and Wolfgang actually accepted. Why, you might ask. Without Wolfgang, ISIS would not have existed. I remember very well spring of 2005 when Wolfgang asked me to join him in proposing something for some initiative that is coming up. Nobody knew any details at the time. Nobody knew that this would occupy us for the next 12 years or so. I remember when on the way to our faculty meeting, we hashed out a name, Institute for Advanced Study, CS. All the elements of ISIS, including junior research groups, the doctoral fellow independence, all the focus, scientific focus of ISIS on modern inverse problems would not have existed without Wolfgang. These elements have all his fingerprints. And that's why I think there can be no more suitable speaker for the Charlemagne lecture as Wolfgang Marquardt. I'm very happy to, for Rosalia to continue to introduce this biography.
Received many awards. I'm going just to list two of them. The Arnold Eucken Prize by the Association of German Engineers in 1990, and the prestigious Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz Prize from the German Research Association in 2001. Besides his comprehensive teaching and his research activities, Professor Marquardt was a dedicated member of the management committees of multiple collaborative research centers. In particular, he was the speaker of the Collaborative Research Center SBF 540, model-based experimental analysis of kinetic phenomena in fluid multiphase reactive systems. Moreover, he was a member of management committee of the excellent cluster tailor-made fuels for biomass, and of different scientific advisory boards, as well as of several national and international associations in the fields of process engineering. In addition, he was a member of the strategy board of FBA Aachen University between 2007 and 2011. Moreover, he was a pioneer in promoting the study of computational engineering science. In fact, he was, together with Professor Schrader, Damen, Peters, and Bischoff, the initiator of the program Computational Engineering Science. The program started in 2012 and was one of the earliest programs of this kind in Germany. He then chaired the curriculum committee for the Computational Engineering Science that also developed the International Master's Study Program in Simulation Sciences in 2001. And as already mentioned by Professor Baer, most importantly for us, it was together with Professor Baer and Professor Damen, the coordinator of the Aachen Institute for Advanced Study of Computational Engineering Science, from the first concept in 2005, over the first review in 2006, and the startup until 2010, which is why we are particularly delighted that he accepted our invitation to be our guest speaker today. So, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in giving a warm welcome to Professor Marquardt.
Designing an energy system, and the key issue here is to stabilize the grid, the volatile grid, by looking at storage of electricity, but also demand side management. And in the second part of the technical part of the lecture, I'd like to focus on control methods with an emphasis on hierarchical and distributed architectures, in particular from systems and control or computational engineering point of view. I think this is really where the heat is turned on. This is more bread and butter, but also computationally quite interesting and demanding. And in the end, very few words on plans we have at the moment in Jülich in this context. The Helmholtz Association, which Jülich is part of, is shown here. The centers, in fact, are shown here on the map. 18 centers in total. Activities are in these six research fields: energies, earth and environment, matter, key technology. This is fundamental physics, basically. Key technologies, health, aeronautics, space, and transport. And this is kind of a short version of the mission statement. Grand challenges which face society, science, and industry, strategic programs, long-term strategic programs, large-scale infrastructures, and knowledge and technology transfer. This is the main terms of the mission of Helmholtz. Jülich itself, though centered here very close by, has a few subsidies distributed among Germany, and Jülich is actively pursuing research in these four fields. Our leading term, guiding terms here, key technologies enabling technologies for the next generation in two related to two main fields, information and brain, and energy and environment. Roughly 6,000 people work for the research center. Here is some budget figures. Roughly 900 plus doctoral students are associated with the center. There is also a convocational training program. At the moment, there are 320 apprentices at Jülich. Then there is the project administration branch, a fairly large branch, about 1,000 people. Of these, 5,600 are working for the Projektträger and developing and administering programs, research programs, project funding for the ministries, for the federal but also state ministries, also for the European Union. So it's not just administrating in the sense of bookkeeping, but it's really developing from an idea coming from the ministries, research programs, and then accompanying basically the whole website of such a program. Then, last but not least, the Yaga collaboration, part of the Excellence Initiative. It was initiated in 2008, I think. Seven. Well, we had just the 10 years anniversary, so it must have been seven. The Yaga collaboration between Aachen and Jülich, which is very important for both sides. So, a few impressions. This is the campus, a campus area. This is a few pictures related to the research we are doing in energy materials. Is at the core, materials research for energy applications. Then we are focusing on renewable energies. One is photovoltaics, the transport of electrons, basically. The other one is on all the electrochemical processes. So there, the transport of ions is most important. And this is fuel cells, this is batteries, this is electrolysis, to mention the most important ones. Then there is some reminiscence from the past. We are actually still active in nuclear waste management. There is just a tiny little bit of reactor safety, nuclear reactor safety, but phase that out in the next few years. There is some atmospheric science related to air quality, and this way related to the energy research, so we look at this as the energy and environment cluster. Then there is plant sciences, agrosciences, biotechnology, this is what we call bioeconomy sciences, then supercomputing, data analysis, simulation at the largest scale, and electronics, microelectronics, nanoelectronics, spintronics, bioelectronics, so the information technology part, very much driven by materials and solid-state physics. And last but not least, the life sciences part, medical part, brain research is the focus after concentrating and focusing a broader medical program in the past. So understanding how the brain works and functions is at the core of this research. There was one Nobel Prize awarded to Peter Grünberg in 2007. So this is just to give you an idea about the setting. That was kind of the intro to you. Let me look briefly at the German Energiewende. You know all of it, I think, so two figures really are completely sufficient. We have to remember the targets for the German energy system by 2050. Power consumption should be reduced to 75%. The fraction of renewables, that's the green part, should be raised to 80%, so that is power cross energy, electrical power cross energy consumption. The target is to reduce it by 50%, have a 60% share of renewables, and greenhouse gas emission, the target here is to reduce it at least to 20%. What you see here is the actual, this is kind of the targets, and this is the actual data. You can see that somehow it follows, but if we look very carefully, there are some interesting observations here. It doesn't really follow. It flattens in the last couple of years, and this could be another talk why this is the case. So very ambitious goals. It's going to be ambitious from technical but also public policy point of view, and it will be expensive, that's for sure. So the real challenge is that we have high volatility and an extremely large decentralization of power generation. This just shows some projection, 2020, 2030, 2040, 2050. In gray there is basically the load which we can expect over the cycle of the day, and these curves show basically the residual load. And you can see that if we look at the scenario in 2050, there will be a lot of negative residual. That means that there is too much electricity for part of the day or part of the season. So dealing with this problem that we have the demand and the availability not really matching very well, that's one of the issues. The other one is the high fluctuation, that's another projection to 2030, where you can show, you can see the residual load here in green if it's positive, in red if it's negative. What is interesting is to see the time frequency pattern. Yeah, we have fairly high peaks here, that's one, but you can see that there are fast fluctuation, and then there are periods of a few days where there is, for example, not enough. Okay, an interesting point from an optimization and computational point of view, from an economical point of view, it's all coming together here. If you look at the current electricity crisis, household, industry, a big difference, but this is not as interesting. What is really interesting is the very low price at the spot market. So if anybody can exploit the price at the spot market, that means basically scheduling the whole energy system such that we use a lot of electricity at this price and not so much at the high price, this makes an enormous economical difference. At the moment, there is not so much we can do, because at the moment we have, as you remember, we have roughly 30% electricity by fluctuating energies. If this is increasing to 40-50%, then the optimization opportunities really kick in. Yeah, this is kind of the threshold which is estimated where we can kind of really do something about it, and that's to be expected in the next few years, so there is still time to prepare, but then those who are first will make nice profit here. Okay, so this is basically where we operated in. Yeah, we have a large complex energy system, high volatility, and we do not have a nice match between demand and supply. So what can we do? Basically, storage and demand side management. This is what we need to look at, and let me start first with storage. There is one example for a key technology, one example which is very much actively researched at Jülich. It's fuel cells, and here reversible solid oxide fuel cells, where you can basically use electricity or generate electricity by operating this solid oxide fuel cell in two modes, in an electrolysis mode. There you generate basically hydrogen by using electricity, and you produce electricity by combining the hydrogen with the oxygen in an electrochemical reaction in the SOFC in the fuel cell. So it's the same device, but operated just in forward and backward mode. A lot of interesting problems. One is the question of at which temperature is this operated. If we operate that fairly at the right temperature, and if we use the various heat loads which are available and integrate it with the rest of the process, we can get really high efficiencies. Yeah, depending on the voltage here, we can go up to a 200 to 95, say, percent of efficiency. So that's why this is a quite interesting device. The problem is that it doesn't scale yet to very large sizes, but this is on the way. So why is this interesting from a storage point of view? Basically, this reversible solid oxide fuel cells can be integrated in a clever way with a chemical reaction to make up to make a new storage system for electricity, where we convert power to chemicals and then back to power in a closed system, like a power plant, but a completely green one with zero emissions, as we will see. So what you do, basically, you run that system in a charge mode. So you decompose water, you split water in hydrogen and oxygen, and in the charge mode, and in the discharge mode, you combine water, hydrogen and oxygen to form water. And you combine this because here you need to supply heat, and here you have to get rid of heat. You combine this with a chemical reaction, which provides that heat and uses the heat needed and laid off by that system. And as you can see, that's a reversible chemical reaction. So we have the reactant A, we have the hydrogen in form B, and here we use that very B and decompose it in A again and hydrogen again. If this works properly, so at 100% conversion and selectivity, this would be the ideal system. And if we look at the chemicals doing this, we find very familiar ones, which are known and industrially produced for 100 years. Ammonia is one of them. It is stored in large volumes, easy to handle. Basically, the substrates to form it is water and air. It's nitrogen. Yeah? So it's nice molecules, and there are no side products and simple separation. So that's a nice molecule to look at. Well, the concept has been worked out by my last PhD students here in Aachen, which was also then, of course, supervised by Alexander Mitzas in recent years. He worked this out in more detail, so that's basically the principle we have seen before. There is something which is also needed, a liquefaction cycle. We store that ammonia in liquid form, just to have a compact way of storing it, so we have to evaporate and liquefy this in the system. We have storage tanks, and there is integration going on all everywhere. So what is important, it's a closed system. Yeah, it's a closed system, no emissions. So we did some study, performance of the normal steady state operation, the scenario 100 megawatt capacity. So the motivation is you have a wind park. And what you want to do is you have just, you know, constant electricity, constant power delivery. So what is the device you need in order to have wind park plus device to have continuous power production? And that's why the 100 megawatt is a reasonable capacity to play with. 10 hours of charge and discharge time, 4 hours per day of storage time, where needle charge or discharge is necessary. We have formulated a model, not a very complicated and detailed model, just to get the concept, with about 30,000 variables and equations, and about exactly seven out of those are the decision variables. Basically, mathematically, what we formulated is a nonlinear program, a large scale nonlinear program, sparse, with inequality constraints as well as equality constraints. This can be solved with quasi-standard solvers. It's not easy to solve. We can talk about this later, but in principle, it's standard algorithms. So what is the result? We can either optimize for efficiency or for cost. Efficiency means maximizing the efficiency, yeah, from, say, the solar energy, if it's solar power, to electricity again. Yeah? From electricity to electricity. That's the efficiency which is 72% at this storage cost, 35 dollar cent per kilowatt hour. And if we do it, if we minimize cost, we go get down to 0.24 dollar cent, but the efficiency is suffering quite a bit. The breakdown, this is also interesting because it sees where the problem is. It shows where the problem is. Here, the 63% of the cost is coming from the fuel cell. And this is good news, because that is not mature technology yet. Yeah? We can expect to get this cost factor down half, maybe a third, some people claim a fourth, but that's it. Yeah? So this is where still the potential for further development. If we were able to build a fuel cell of the size we need here, this is basically how it looks in the cost efficiency chart, and it compares very nicely to hydro storage system. That's what we do. You think of the hydro storage systems in the mountains or compressed air storage. So this is using geological formations basically. If you compare it to more fancy solutions, batteries or vanadium flow batteries, we have quite favorable situation here, so this looks quite nice. If we want to scale it down, for example, for our house at home, the cost goes up tremendously. So that is something which is for large-scale power plants, basically, and not for small-scale applications. This is the typical economy of scale we see in all the chemical processes. Let me switch to the next problem. Demand-side management. Demand-side-based management basically means, well, we adjust the usage of electricity to the supply, yeah, and try to make it match just by ramping up or ramping down the activity of an industrial process or your dishwasher at home whatsoever. Yeah. So that's demand-side management. Again, we looked at ammonia, not because of some relation to the problem before, but by principle, that's an interesting, very energy demanding process, basic chemicals process in industry. And what you see here is a very rough sketch of the established ammonia process. So we take some fossil hydrocarbon, for example methane here. We use air, separate the air to get the nitrogen. From here, by steam reforming, we get hydrogen, and we combine the two to ammonia. The problem here is because here we just use the hydrogen, not the carbon. We have extremely large emissions, 1.7 tons of CO2 per ton ammonia, and that is not so nice. So the question is, can we do something else? Well, we could. We just remove the cracker by some electrolysis plant to produce hydrogen from green power. And we run the air separation also the same way. That means we produce hydrogen from water and solar or wind power by means of electrolysis. Yeah, with a similar process as we used before. Yeah, the SOFC is also an electrolysis unit. We can do zero emissions here, that is the nice thing. And one important problem is, this is a high temperature process, we have to evaporate the water. Where comes the heat to do that? If we have to supply heat by the general sources, it wouldn't really be a wise design and not an economical design. However, if we combine it with some chemical process which generates surplus heat, we can do this in a very efficient way. And in this case, we use nitric acid because the ammonia is used by the nitric acid plant, but that's just a matter of choice here. And in this case, we still keep the zero CO2 emission for the ammonia part. We have heat integration with a nitric acid plant, and we get a very highly energy efficient plant. The interesting problem here comes next. Yeah, that's a nice design, but it's transient operation, and the operators in chemical industry don't like their plant moving around. Yeah, they want to have everything straightened out. So in order to have robust operations, we have to do automatic control, yeah, in order to really stabilize the system. So we need an optimal design, we have to design a control system, and then we have to do optimal control basically for the transient operation, for optimizing the transients basically. It's like a robot, yeah? You know, maybe that problem, if we want to optimize the movement of a robot, that's the very same thing. Yeah? We have to do a transition from A to B, and that's what we do in those plants here too. So basically, the mathematical problems we have to solve, again, the nonlinear program which we had before, and now to do the second problem, it's an optimal control problem. This is differential algebraic equation, so M is a singular matrix. We have inequalities, and solving these kind of problems for a large number of equations is really still a challenge. And I mean, it's solvable, but it's fairly tough problem to do so. And in this case, we have, say, yeah, you have single number of equations. So in the order of 50,000 equations, nonlinear differential algebraic equations, that's what you have. Just to give you an order of magnitude, that's the least you have to use here. So again, a look at the results. So this is the design study we did. So we looked at wind power, and we decided to have two plants. We have a plant which is operated in stationary mode, and one which is operated in transient mode. And here we have a storage system. Yeah, you can imagine to use the storage system conceptually as we have seen before. So a real power generation scenario, we look for a cost optimal design. The design variables are basically all the parameters of the plant, of the equipment, and the reference load trajectory. Yeah? So how do we move the plant in order to make that? What you see here is the blue curve is a real scenario, wind power supply, data from February 2014. And the yellow or brown curve here is the optimal power demand for a certain scenario. And you can see here why we need this steady-state plant with a storage system, because if there is no wind, yeah, this is for example here and there, or if the wind falls below this threshold, we shut down the transient plant, and we work from the storage with a steady-state plant to robustify the system. If we do this, the question is always, is this economical? Very important. Well, not quite, but it's not so bad. Yeah, this is basically the production cost for three scenarios, depending on the lifespan of the process. And this is different shutout scenarios here, the different points. So you see for, in those cases, we are close to the market range level in the last 5 years. So it's still not economically viable, but it's close. Okay, so that was a glance in these design problems, and also some hints on the numerical and the computational problems we have to solve. Those problems, by the way, these problems, that's an offline optimization. So we do this kind of in the office, yeah, just once to design the system. If we want to operate this, we have to solve that problem in real time. Yeah? Real time means a couple of times a day, basically, yeah, 5 times, 10 times a day. But that's the real job. Good. Now, moving on to the next section, control methods and operation strategies. Basically, what is the objective if you operate a technical process or a chemical plant, an energy plant? Basically, we want to be optimal, and this means economically optimal, at any point in time. And we want to be safe on the other hand. So on, yeah, but these are constraints, yeah, safety, environment, equipment restrictions, quality, and so on. But economical optimal, that's what we shoot at. We are faced with process uncertainties, yeah. The process may change, a catalyst in a reactor, heat exchanger may foul, and the heat transfer will change over time. There are disturbances like our fluctuating energy demand, and that means we have to do decision making in real time or optimization, real time optimization with optimal control techniques. That means we determine the manipulated variables as a function of time, and we schedule by discrete decisions parts of plants or operational strategies. I will come back to this later. So just look at the manipulated variables. Yeah, the valves basically in the process. Yeah? Which adjusts, for example, the capacity of the process or the level at which we operate, the temperature level, for example. So what does that mean? Well, a large number of nonlinear differential algebraic equations, this is basically the range we are facing with. Can we do this today? No, we can't. In real time, we can do a couple of hundred, a couple of thousand, if we work very hard, but not a couple of 10,000 or even. So this is still at the moment. optimization is formulated mathematically by this problem. You can see here the objective function. This is basically, in this case, it's a quadratic functional. This is an endpoint penalty. This is basically the deviations of the state from a reference, which is deliberately taking a zero here for the sake of simplicity, and that's the control equation, which we penalize. These are the, in this case, formulated as differential equations for the sake of simplicity. The model, basically equations, that's the constraints, box constraints in this case, just for the sake of simplicity. And then we discretize, basically. Also, we can do this in algorithms, but we don't have to do it necessarily. But here, in this case, we just discretize the control variables and we leave the state variables as continuous variables. And then, at a certain point in time, we assume that we know the initial state, the full state of the plant. Yeah? So all the differential variables here are known, which is not the case, but assume. And then what we do, basically, we solve this problem on the prediction horizon. This is the time from current T0 to TF. Yeah? We solve the problem on this horizon and leave the manipulated variables as degrees of freedom, here discretized by these step functions, on a so-called control horizon. And then we implement just the first control move. And after this time period, we do the same thing again. And that means moving horizon. Yeah? We do a computation, we determine a control sequence, implement the first, while we are implementing, we move the horizon and do the same thing again, recursively. Now what do we do with respect to this question? We don't know that state. Well, we do some assimilation. We call it state reconstruction. That means we do the very same thing looking into the back. We formulate a receding horizon estimation problem, the purpose of which is to estimate the full state from available measurements, observed states, basically. So that's what we do. We call this economical MPC because that's an economical objective function. Now, what are the challenges? I mean, this is really, really big, yeah? And the plant is structured. That's obviously, it's composed of many subsystems. So we can do it in a centralized way. Look at the full problem, yeah? A couple of 100,000 equations, no way, I don't think can ever do this, I mean, at least in my lifetime. Or we can distribute, decompose. And that's something which is commonly done in control and operations in the chemical industries. Yeah, we break it down into pieces and look at sub-problems. So a decomposition, we call it distributed model predictive controller, and it's a decentralized approach where we have to account for interaction between the subsystems. And then, in this case, still, we assume that the full state is available. If the state is not available, we have to add here an estimator. Yeah? Getting from the observables the states in order to run these model predictive controllers. And I'll run through these examples quickly. So the centralized, this is just solving the optimal control problem in real time. That's not so interesting. Computational half, but not that interesting. Let's look at these other two cases, the distributed MPC. Basically, the challenges are we want to have optimality. Yeah, despite the decomposition, we want to have the same quality of the solution as in the fully centralized case. Yeah. Convergence, well, that means if it's an iterative problem, we want to converge basically to the solution of the decentralized system. It has to be stable. That's not stability in the numerical sense, but stability in the feedback sense. Yeah? If you have a feedback system, you may run unstable just because of positive feedback, for example. It has to be computational efficient, and we don't want a solution which we have to tweak and tailor for each new problem we want to address. So that's the challenges. There are classical approaches to the distribution of optimal control problems, optimization problems, dating back to the 70s. It's called dual decomposition. The colleague here from Delft, Lindenbaum, he used this in that context the first time. This converges very, very slowly, by the way, this technique, so we looked at something else. But at the same time, an alternative concept, another decomposition scheme has been suggested by colleagues of Lasten, Stanovich, and colleagues, and we have adopted this kind of idea, and I'll show you what this is all about for the linear case. So that's a continuous optimal control problem, now in this case linear. We do some transcription, that means discretizing the, in this case, the controls and the states, projecting this infinite object onto a finite object in an approximation sense, so we get a quadratic program in this case, and we solve this quadratic program iteratively after decomposing it. Now you can see that it nicely decomposes. Now we have additive here, objective function, and we have here the subsystem for each of the inequalities for each of the subsystems. Basically, we solve that minimization problem, but we don't look at this one. We use this sensitivity correction. This is the sensitivity of the objective, and multiply and a penalty which is composed by some Lagrange parameters, and the sensitivity of the constraint. This is basically the sensitivity correction, which hopefully gives us nice properties: convergence, stability, optimality. This is, well, just a comment. This has been kind of heuristically derived. Yeah, the guys in 1970, they had an idea that should work. Yeah, there was no proof, nothing like that. Even later, people didn't look at it. So that was a plausibility argument that this kind of correction should work. So the question again, optimality, convergence, efficiency, that's the problem. Well, we looked at this, optimality, convergence, efficiency, this is really done. Stability, we have not really a full proof yet. So for the linear systems, it's done. We have benchmarked it with simple nonlinear systems, but all these properties are not proven for the nonlinear case. So distributed state estimation. Now, the estimator here. Yeah? In order to do this in reality, we have to estimate. The classical approaches, some of you know them. The Kalman filter is really used widely in many different variants, and that is one of the state estimators we can use. This is not very well fitting, this receding moving horizon principle. Yeah, this has not been used by these people, Wilberg and Kalman, in the 60s. But later people have looked at this moving horizon idea. There were estimators formulated in a centralized for a centralized estimator, and also partition based, that means decomposed estimation schemes, which we have also studied recently. So what we are looking at is an iterative, inherently parallel algorithm with an optimal performance, optimal as the centralized estimator. That's the idea. And we use the same kind of sensitivity-based decomposition. It looks a little bit awkward here, but basically that's a discretized in time version of what we have seen before. We use the same transcription as before, and we use the same basically decomposition and penalty idea as before. We look at the theoretical properties. Optimality is hard to do. For reasons which you can easily explain. Convergence, stability, efficiency, however, are done. And again, we have the theory almost complete for linear systems, but not for non-linear systems at this point. Now putting this together, basically you use a distributed controller with distributed state estimators. And again, that's kind of standard using Leuenberg and Kalman type of approaches, but not this receding horizon approach. That's something we looked at, and this is just a small demonstrator problem, a simple conceptual problem, small scale, 130 nonlinear differential algebraic equations, 25 states, 5 controls, 6 measurements, a linear model for a nonlinear plant, and this basically, without going into detail, shows it works. Yes, it works also for the nonlinear case, and it shows nice properties, really nice properties, though we have not been able to. So many open issues. The formulation is still could be improved for stability, for example. Efficiency of algorithms is important, and integrating this in an output feedback that we see for real-time problems. Let's look at this one again. Yeah, I'm almost out of time here, so I may shorten some. So this is you have seen that before, yeah. So this is the control problem we looked at before, and what I want to address here a little bit is the real time issue. Yeah. So far we have not talked about real time algorithms or requirements or tricks of the trade what we can do. to you in the following. So using this transcription for the inputs, the controls, and the disturbances, we can convert that basically to a nonlinear program. This is a nonlinear program, but what we have embedded is the solution of this of the dynamic system. Yeah? So this is kind of hiding the complexity of this, this notation. Yeah? It's an NLP with an embedded dynamic system. And we want to do this efficiently. Yeah? Efficiently. And we can do this if we use the fact that this is basically a parametric nonlinear program. It's a parametric nonlinear program. And for parametric programs, we know that something can be done. Yeah, the parameters P, basically, are these parametrizing the nonlinear control problem. Where are they coming from? The parameters P are discrete representations of the disturbance. Yeah, of the unknown, for example, varying load of my process, or the initial conditions are also disturbances. So that's the vector of parameters. And from one time step to the next, this vector P will change, yeah, because the initial conditions will change, the reference conditions, and also my disturbance will change, because I move on in time. Yeah. So we are close in the sense, yeah, after one time step, we are close in the piece to the one before, but there are changes. And that's the idea, basically. So we decompose this. On the upper level we have a slow controller, on the lower level we have a fast controller. So we do the slow dynamics here and the fast dynamics there. The slow controller, that's basically the same we had before, and we do this on a very large sampling time, yeah, maybe once in an hour or so, but not once in a minute. This controller we would like to execute once in a minute or every 10 seconds or so, and obviously that's impossible using the. So what we do basically, we use an updating algorithm to do a fast tracking control. Yeah, the track, the trajectories, the nominal trajectories are computed by the slow controller, and that fast controller just tries to follow them and rejects the disturbances on a fast time scale. So that's basically the idea. And how to do this? Well, we use that parametrized NLP and use sensitivity information to generate fast approximations of the controls by an optimal update. So we compute on the upper level the optimal solution, we compute some sensitivity information, and then we use a parametric representation. Basically, it's a linearization, if you wish, a linearization of the problem on top of the NLP on top at the point, the P, at the previous time step. Yeah? And this is a QP, always, with a set of constraints here, inequality constraints, and that can be solved. And what is nice, we can even handle changes in the active set of this quadratic program. And then we just solve that QP, we can solve QPs, even very large ones, very, very quickly, and we do an update. Yeah? This is the measured, basically, change in the parameters, and we do an update in the controls in these LCs by this approach. And that works nicely. It has also some nice theoretical properties, because this kind of fast controller is fully consistent with the controller on the top. That's a property which has been looked for quite some time in the controller theory. Okay, so last problem is we can distribute that. Yeah, we can do the very same thing as I showed you before on that level. I skipped that, but that is also possible. Last idea is, well, we have discrete decisions. We have discrete decisions. Why do we have discrete decisions? I'll show you in a second. Basically, we handle the discrete decisions on that level, on the slow level. Now we make decisions on the structure of the process on a very, say, moderate time scale. Yeah, that means we win on the level of slow control. In essence, the low sampling rate helps us to do more computations here, because we need a hybrid, a switching control, switching really systems, model equations at the end. And the rest is the same as before. So we just changed this one. Why at all do we want to do discrete decisions? Well, we want to adjust the operational strategy to the context. We want to make decisions in a certain situation. And this situation may mean that we run different strategies at a certain time, in a certain time interval. And those strategies could be, well, we want to do different products, yeah, in a chemical process settings. We want to produce A now and B in a few hours. It could be a different process structure, different connectivity. Think of the energy system. We may have a wind farm and a photovoltaics plant. We may shut down one versus the other. Or for maintenance, we shut down a wind turbine for some time. So that's the configuration, basically, of the process. And the third one, we may have different objectives. Cost, efficiency, flexibility, whatsoever. And if we look at this, basically, that means we have to schedule these strategies in a sequence over time. And we have to do this in real time. Yeah, because we want to make decisions in real time. So that means we do all the same what we have seen before, plus deciding on the sequence of these operational modes or operational strategies. And that's basically the highest level of complexity you can imagine, because first of all, you have to formulate a multi-stage optimization problem. Right? So we have an optimization problem for each of those strategies, and we have to connect them here by transition conditions. This is called multi-stage optimal control problem. So that's the first thing we need to do, and this is sketched here with a slightly different notation. The differential algebraic equations are here in implicit form. This is the initial condition, that's the stage transition conditions. Here we have to map the states from the previous stage to the next stage. And all the rest is the optimal control problem, as you know it before. So that's the part without the sequence. Now we have to decide on that sequencing problem, and that's obviously a discrete decision-making problem, which can be formulated nicely by so-called disjunctions. Yeah, we use kind of a logic framework to write it down. This is just the problem representation. I don't think I have the time to explain this, but you can see that this is a logical or. This is a certain Boolean variable. This can be true or not true. Yeah, if it's true, this set of equation holds. If it's not true, that set of equation holds. So basically what that means, depending on the value of that logic binary variable, we switch the set of equations between a few realizations, basically. Yeah? And the realization means for each stage we have a different realization. So the number of stages is a crucial parameter for complexity. Disjunctions cannot be addressed directly numerically. We map those into a mixed integer, nonlinear program, or a mixed integer optimal control problem, and then we go from there. Quite some machinery to end up with a solution. Yeah, so that was kind of a glimpse on problems, interesting challenges, also from a computational point of view. Two slides on a project we are currently working at Jülich, because you know this is all really new technologies. Yeah, the devices I have shown you, the system designs, the operational strategies, we would not be able to roll that out soon in a larger setting. No case. This is kind of engineering, but long-term fundamental engineering systems kind of research. So what we need to do is basically to demonstrate and to have a research infrastructure where we can play with all kinds of things, with devices, but also with operational strategies, for example. And that's what we want to do in Jülich. Yeah? We not only want to do research in the field of energy, but use the energy system on campus for doing research. That means we want to evolve the Jülich campus, and the project has started, we are just at the very beginning, into a real-world large-scale demonstrator where we can play with these model-based design and operational strategies of a decentralized urban. It's kind of a village, you know. After 7 o'clock, it's kind of dark there, but during the day, it's like a village. An urban energy system. And this is basically the challenges we face, you know, spatial temporal system dynamics, technology components. We want to look at systems integration, and also user integration and empowerment. And this is the challenges, real-time data processing, data analytics, simulation and optimization. The question behind this is, you know, there is a lot of noise at the moment coming from the West Coast in the US, you know, using just the data you have and you tweak your energy system and everything is fine. I don't believe that this is really working, but I know to study this with a scientific approach, you have to do it model-based and knowing all about the system, compare it with a black box, just data-driven strategy. And in the end, as always, the truth will lie in the middle, but we will need some first principles or structural knowledge which can be passed into simulation optimization. Well, technically, it boils down to the problem of integrating multi-scale dynamic models, highly resolved data, and new decision-making under uncertainty, and obviously we need high-performance computing of a future generation, yeah, not an exascale computer, but a parallel computing system. Yeah, this is what I wanted to show you, and this is my final slide. I like these icebergs quite a bit. Remember what has been decided in Paris 2 years ago. Trump remembers that very well, but wants to forget it, obviously. Others don't, and I hope that the majority will not forget it. You want to and need to limit the surface air temperature to 2 Kelvin. What is interesting is that if you look at the communique from Paris 2015, they said that we should even shoot at 1.5 Kelvin. If you talk about, to the climate scientists, they tell you, no way, this is too late, we will not be able to make it there. So this is a clear, and these people knew who formulated the text, so that's a very clear political message here to take it very seriously. And I think we all should get involved in order to make that. That's a challenge for Germany, but also for mankind in a global sense. And I am convinced that computational methods will definitely make the difference in this. The complexity we face cannot be resolved just by tweaking the system in engineering in an engineering manner. This needs rigorous computation at the large scale. And a few modest attempt steps, I hope I was able to show. Thank you very much.